Today we are going to talk about how to integrate improper integrals involving some multivalued function, which is something you will need to know when you eventually try to integrate real functions like this one here by using complex analysis. And we are once again going to do it by using Cauchy's residue theorem. So let's get going. As you might already know, a function is called multivalued if there exists an input value that is mapped to two or more output values. An example of this sort of mapping is illustrated in the figure below. Here you can see that the input value C1 is mapped to both W1 and W2. And this is a big problem when doing integration, because it's kind of hard to integrate something that can be two or more values at the same time. Some typical examples of multivalued functions, and the ones you're going to look out for in this course, are the logarithm and the square root function. Both of these two are multivalued, but fear no more, we can make them single-valued by choosing a branch cut. Because when you choose a branch cut for a multivalued function, it's the same thing as restricting it, so that it only can map one input value to one output value, which is going to be so much easier to integrate. So let's say you would like to determine this real integral here. The first thing we are going to do is to rewrite this integral as a contour integral instead. And the easiest way to do this is to swap all the x's to c's, and when we do that for the function in this case, we get the following. But notice here that the function f we end up with will be multivalued, since we have a square root of c in the denominator. And as we stated above, this is something we cannot integrate. So the next thing we will have to do is to choose a branch cut to make our function f, in this case, single-valued. And after that, the last thing we have to do to create our contour integral is to choose a contour. And the important things here are that the contour cannot cross a pole, a singularity in this case, or the branch cut that you have chosen. In this case, we can for example let the branch cut go along the real axis, and then we can make the contour look something like this. This contour is called a keyhole contour. It consists of two circles, a small one with radius r, and a larger one with radius capital R. And then we connect these two circles with two parallel lines, one at each side of the branch cut. And by using this setup, we have managed to avoid the two poles, the one at 0 and the one at -2. And note that there are actually multiple setups that work for our case here. You could, for example, take our first figure here and rotate it a bit to make it look something like this. And this new setup would also be valid to use. But just remember that you cannot use the last one here, for example, since the contour in that case crosses one of the poles, so that one would not be valid. But here we actually have two different setups to choose from, so which one are we going to pick? I'm going to stick with the first one, and the reason why is because the first one contains lines that goes horizontal to the real axis, and these two lines are essential to determine the integral we started with. The next thing we are going to do is that we are going to break up our big contour gamma into four parts. The first one, gamma r, is simply going to be the bigger circle here. And then we are going to have gamma 1, and that is the horizontal line that goes from the big circle to the smaller circle. Then we have gamma r for our smaller circle inside here. And lastly we have gamma 2, which is going to be the horizontal line that goes from the smaller circle to the bigger circle. Everything that's left for us to do now is to solve our new contour integral, which we can do by using Cauchy's residue theorem. And then we can use that this integral along gamma is going to be equal to the sum of integrals along the parts, according to this equation. And by doing that, we will be able to determine the integral we started with. So let's do that. Here we have the integral in question, which I'm just going to write as the following. And now we can solve it by using this checklist here to the right. We start off by swapping all the x to c's, and then we have to take care of our multivalued function, the square root of c in this case. So we have to choose a branch cut to make it single value. And since we know that c is equal to the following in polar representation, then we know that the square root of c is going to be equal to the following. And now we can create the same setup as we had before, so we choose our branch cut to be along the real axis, so at 2π in this case, and then we can just choose the same keyhole contour as we had before. And since we managed to split up our big contour gamma into four parts, we also know that the integral along gamma must be equal to the sum of the integrals along the parts. So the thing we are going to do now is that we are going to solve the left side of this equation by using Cauchy's residue theorem, and then we will continue by solving the rest of the integrals, which we will do while having that the radius of our big circle is going to approach infinity. Meanwhile, the radius of our small circle is going to approach zero. So the integral along our contour gamma is going to be equal to the following. And as we said, we can solve this one by using Cauchy's residue theorem. And in this case here, we're only going to have one pole that's inside of our contour gamma. And that one is going to be located at minus 2. And therefore, we are going to end up with the following expression. The residue can be determined as usual by using this formula here. So if we just insert c is equal to minus 2 into this formula, we get the following. And this thing can be simplified a bit to the following. And if I just do the rest of the calculations, we are going to end up with minus I divided by the square root of 2. Now we can insert this value up here. And then we know for a fact that minus I times I is going to be equal to 1. So we can use that to simplify this expression to the following. So by doing that, we have managed to solve one integral and have four more to go. So let's continue to the next one. The integral along the big circle is going to be equal to the following. And we are going to solve this one by using the ML inequality. We are going to bound the integral and then show that this upper bound is equal to zero as we take our limits. If we take the absolute value of our function f, we get the following. And then if we use the triangle inequality and the fact that the length of all the complex numbers on this contour are going to be equal to capital R, then we get that this expression is going to be equal or lesser than the following. So this means that the absolute value of our integral in question is going to be equal or lesser than the following. And notice here that the first factor is simply the length of a contour, which in this case is going to be equal to 2 pi times capital R, which is going to be the case when r approaches zero. And if we now let our capital R approach infinity, then this whole expression is going to be equal to zero, since the capital R's in the numerator are going to grow so much faster than the single capital R in the numerator. And this means that the limit that we started with up here, that one is also going to be equal to zero. And we can actually use the same principle when we are looking at our next contour. This integral is going to be equal to the following, and the absolute value of a function is the same as before, so the following. And now if we use the triangle inequality, but this time we have to remember that the length of the complex numbers on this contour are not capital R anymore, they're just R, since the radius of this contour is R. So by using that, we end up with the following expression. So this means that the absolute value of our integral in question is going to be equal or lesser than the following. And here we once again have that the first term is equal to the length of the contour, which in this case is going to be equal to 2 pi r, as r becomes sufficiently small, which is absolutely going to be the case since we are letting r approach zero. And if we now simplify the expression a bit, we get the following. And now we might more easily see that if we now let r approach zero, then this whole expression also will be equal to zero. And therefore the limit up here is going to be equal to zero. For our next integral, we are going to tackle the one that goes along gamma 1. I'm just going to draw here a bit and we're going to enhance the area we're looking at. So the contour in question goes from some starting point, s1 here, to some endpoint, e1, let's say. And if we use these two values and insert them into our expression down here, we get the following. And now I'd like us to explore what would happen if we let r approach zero. Because if we let r approach zero, then this contour gamma 1 will go closer and closer to the real axis, right? So that means that if r approaches zero, then that means that our c values will simply approach x, since we no longer have any imaginary part for our complex numbers, if we just go along the real axis. And in the case of a square root function, we can first of all use the definition to get the following expression. And since we are approaching the real axis from below, the angle in question is going to become 2 pi, as r approaches zero. And our length of a complex number, the absolute value of c in this case, is simply going to become x. So if we insert this information into the formula, and then simplify a bit, we get the following. And here I would like you to notice that this last factor here is simply going to be equal to minus 1. So this whole thing is equal to minus x raised to the power of 1 divided by 2. Another thing that will happen when we let r approach 0 is that the starting and end point of our integral is going to change. The starting point is simply going to become capital R, and the end point is going to become 0. So if we now use all of this information and let r approach 0 in our expression down here, we get the following. And now we can sacrifice our minus sign in the denominator to swap the start and end points of the integral. And if we do that, we get the following expression, which is the thing we wanted to determine from the start. So that's great. And now we can continue to do the last integral. So the integral along gamma 2 is going to be equal to the following expression. And if we now denote the starting point as S2 and the end point of this contour as E2 and insert it into this expression down here, we get the following. And then if we let r approach 0, then we can see up here that we will once again approach the real axis, but this time from the top. And by doing that, our c values will approach x once more, since you're only going along the real axis and have no imaginary part. But for the square root, then we can see that since we are going from the top and down, the angle in question is going to be 0 this time and not 2 pi. And the length of a complex number is still going to be equal to x. So if we insert this information into this formula here for the square root, we get the following expression. So the square root is going to approach x raised to the power of 1 divided by 2 when r approaches 0. And then we can once again see that our start and end point will change. Our starting point will become 0, and our end point will become capital R when r approaches 0. So if we insert all of this information and let r approach 0 in our expression down here, we get the following. And as you might see now right from the start, this is the same expression we were looking for once again. And this time we didn't even have to change the start and end points. So if we now go back up here and insert the values for each of these integrals, we get the following expression. And here we can see that the right hand side is simply going to be equal to 2i. And then we can rewrite this expression to let us know that I, which is the integral we want to determine, is going to be equal to pi divided by the square root of 2. So just to summarize a bit, we started by rewriting the whole expression as a contour integral, and then we actually got what we wanted as a byproduct when we tried to solve that one instead. But the thing that makes this type of problems unique to the one we did before in the last two videos, for example, is that here we are dealing with a function that is multivalued, so the only real difference is we have to choose a branch here, and that impacts the kind of contour that we can choose. But after that, it's simply the same as before. We use Coach's residue theorem to solve one side of the equation, and then we can solve the rest of the integrals one at a time. And hopefully some of them will be equal to 0. But that was everything for this time. I hope that you learned something new, and thanks for watching.